hear it was a rough night last night.
Not for everyone.
Not for everyone. I apologize for missing yesterday. Mark Carnell reassured me his talk was the best. And there you have it. I'm not going to give any slides today because I think at 10 o'clock in the morning you shouldn't be looking at screens, even though we all seem to want to. Betting on horses. In my career, George Gaylord Simpson, the paleontologist, has always been in the background, sometimes in the foreground. Just a quick straw poll. George Gaylord Simpson, does that name ring a bell? Yes, that's great. That's 10 minutes of talk done. I'm undertaking a project on Simpson's paleontological popularization work. Simpson's bibliography extends to about 750 items. More than half easily falls into the category of popular work. And that's something that falls off the biographical study of Simpson. So one project is what's going on in that material. Recently I've stumbled across, I say that so simply, I've come across, spent some time with, a book that Simpson wrote in 1951 called Horses. And I think it's a quite interesting book. It's an interesting book because it's attempted to do a few things that I don't think people have noticed before. And that's where I'm going to focus my presentation on today. In fact, I want you to walk out of here with a couple of basic ideas in your mind about that book and about Simpson. And one is that 1951 book, Horses, includes a rhetorical strategy of bad Britain, I call it, looking after that. A rhetorical strategy that is well worth us noticing as analysts. The rhetorical strategy has implications for the way we understand the history of evolutionary studies in the 20th century, and I think it's a strategy that has implications for thinking about science communication and public engagement. So a big idea contained in one little book. First, Simpson, if you just a frame you right at the moment, who's Simpson? Simpson, broadly, let's focus on Anglo-American paleontology, let's focus on the 20th century, let's focus on the synthesis period, so roughly 1930 to 1950. Simpson is widely remembered as the paleontologist who delivers the goods. He delivers the goods in terms of evolutionary theory for paleontology. He delivers the goods broadly in an important work called Sample of Bone and Evolution, 1944. Right? So that's the memory's job. We're all back in the game now. What did Temple and Mode do as a work? Well, kind of depends on who you ask. So geneticists say that Temple and Mode is a book that used genetic theory to rewrite paleontology. Systematists say that Temple and Mode is a book that used modern systematic theory to rewrite paleontology. Paleontologists said at the time that what Simpson did was argue the corner of paleontology in amongst systematists and geneticists and got us into the game. So what is the book about? What makes it important? It depends on who you ask. Simpson himself said that his work, Temple and Mode, introduced new theory and new observations about rates of evolution, so the tempo, and new theory in terms of mode, how exactly does it work. And Simpson himself said that what he did was bring together a bit of genetics, a bit of mathematical theory, a bit of new ecological thinking, and a bit of paleo, bring it all together, so hence synthesis. So here's Simpson, he delivers synthesis, he delivers paleontology to synthesis. How does that get accomplished? Depends on who you ask. One of the big ideas that Simpson's always credited for in that period, in that book, is the idea of quantum evolution. That's an idea that might come to your mind. Basically, what Simpson's trying to do is he's trying to explain major changes in morphology, major changes in systematics. So, for example, the rise of a new taxonomic family, or the fundamental shift in the ecological setting in which organisms live. So quantum evolution is meant to be an explanation for a particular phenomenon, those super big changes in evolution, hence the concept of quantum is idea. How does it work? Basically, it's very complicated. It's not what we're trying to worry about, right? It's very simple. Okay? So within temporal and mode evolution, there's quantum evolution as a theoretical element. Simpson and other people present that as one of the big theoretical elements of that work. Okay, back
little bit.
Now, when we tell the story of the Simpson period, when we tell the story of Simpson, broadly put, there's a very conventional interpretation. That's what I just stated here. That Simpson delivers paleo and delivers paleo by presenting bottom evolution and other things. Revisionist interpretation says Simpson did more harm than good. And mostly what this revisionist interpretation delivers is that Simpson may have proposed these ideas in 1944, but as the clock moves forward in the 1950s, Simpson just gets a pasting for that theoretical contribution. It's such a pasting and he has such difficulty that he quite literally does more harm than good. And by the mid-50s, he's retracted his major theoretical innovations completely. And he's adopted what Steve Gould, for example, called the adaptations paradigm. And Gould uses this backtracking to talk about a hardening of the evolutionary synthesis. I think that revisionist interpretation is false. I don't think Simpson walked away from his major theoretical contributions, but I do think something really important happened. And what I'm picking that. The disagreement that I have with the revisionist interpretation gets me into the popular literature. It is definitely the case that after Simpson proposed his theoretical ideas in the Denver Motive, as the 1940s roll forward, it's definitely the case that he took a pacing on that particular, on those particular innovations. Quantum evolution, for example. He said this is a great idea, it's theoretically sound, it's coming out of the cutting edge of evolutionary work. However, critics said, where's the evidence for this? There is just no evidence presented for the view. Simpson is pasted by that. Well, some of Simpson's colleagues tried to provide evidence. Brian Patterson, for example, one of his colleagues in America, presented a fantastic work on tineodonts that demonstrated, he thought very clearly, Simpson's theoretical work underway. It's meant to be a case study of the theory. Simpson, too, sought empirical material to defend his view. And here that book horses comes in. Because it's in the book horses that Simpson presents the strongest case that he ever makes for quantum evolution as a phenomenon that is evidence-backed. Now, that's not the first place he does it, it's not the only place he does it, but in 1951, when he published his horses, he means it to be an empirical presentation. I have trouble with the revisionist account that says Simpson's work hardens and Simpson backs away from quantum evolution. I think what the revisionist account missed was, I think they only looked at the technical literature. And I don't think they looked at the popular literature. I think they rated the popular literature as a place where scientists talk about science. So keep that idea in your mind. Simpson uses horses to present evidence for quantum evolution. That book is a book that's related to exhibition work at the American Museum of Natural History. There's a guidebook at the American Museum on how to read that exhibition. Simpson volunteers to rewrite the guidebook. It goes on sale at the American Museum. It becomes a trade book called Horses because it's a big market for all the horse people. For all the fans of horses to go up to buy. So it's an excellent trade book from Simpson's point of view, from the publisher's point of view, and it's in the popular or trade press, trade universe. Simpson is no novice when it comes to writing popular material. As I said, 750 publications over his career, more than half are easily popular science pieces. Simpson has been writing popular work since the beginning of his career. He wanted to be a journalist early on. A lot of his early work is journalistic in its presentation, a lot of magazine articles. After World War II, a lot of his work, a lot of his popular science work becomes books, trade books, or textbooks. And so, for example, in the early 1950s, there's a flurry of these kinds of writings that Simpson is producing. Now, we've been talking for a very long time about Simpson's rhetorical style in the popular science world. Park that today, let's stay focused on quantum evolution. So what I think Simpson is doing is he's using one specific case of popular science writing to deliver the empirical study that he hasn't been able to produce elsewhere. Well, why does he use a popular science source? Well, the answer, I think, is his work, the evidence that he has on horses, giving an example of quantum evolution, and the evidence itself is fairly thin. In order to deliver the evidence for quantum evolution, it's hard, it's extremely demanding. If the basic argument is very small populations over short periods of time in very isolated spots, essentially a genetic bottleneck. There's a genetic bottleneck in a place, and then bang, there's a big leap across ecological zones, and you get up a whole new kind of organism. The evidence for that requires very careful paleontological work, high resolution stratigraphy. It's only available in a couple of settings, and it's extremely difficult to deliver. Simpson, I think, knows that there is an empirical weakness here. And I think what he's trying to do is deliver as much as he can in a setting that tolerates the amount of evidence that it's got. Now, let's press on a little bit more. So if you remember anything about today, remember Simpson, Temple and Lowe, Delivering the Goods, remember Quantum Evolution, remember that book, Horses, 1951. 1951, that book is still arguing for quantum evolution. Simpson's popular works after that continue to argue for quantum evolution. The revisionists missed this, and if we bring it back into the story, we can revise the revision. Does that make sense on a kind of pop morning conversation? I don't know. Let's press on a little bit more. I think this conversation about focusing on popular literature as a place where technical science gets argued out is well worth keeping our eyes on. I think that Simpson is using a familiar tool, the popular venue, in order to deliver some ideas that he's got about science. I think the reason why he does this is he knows the rules and the standards and the culture are different in popular writing. Now, this comes back to a big idea about the relationship between popular science and technical science. There are a couple of models for the relationship between professional and popular writing. I think we're all familiar with them. One model, for example, talks about translation, that the relationship between professional work and popular work simply is simply a process of translation. You take out the jargon and you simplify the language, you make nicer pictures, and basically that's what popularization is. I myself think that's a crappy model, but nevertheless it's a model that's there. Another kind of model is to say there is a distinction between popular and professional work, that researchers read both and converse with both. The public reads both and converses with both, especially nowadays with open source publishing. That's the second model. A third model says the relationship between popular and professional writing is about separate spheres, that different conversations go on in the different venues. And that, I think, is an important idea, that different conversations go on. So, for example, Michael Bruce, his work, Monads and Man in the 1990s, he argued that he found really different conversations by the same scientists, just using different venues. So he would say, for example, when scientists wanted to talk about theory and mechanism, they use a professional press. When they wanted to talk about bigger ideas like the meaning of life, or where are we all coming from anyway, they used a popular set, because the norms of the community were such that they wanted to distinguish technical and speculative. So Bruce's idea of separate spheres, I think, is really quite interesting. Now, the Simpson example of horses finds a problem with that distinction of separate spheres. Because from Bruce's point of view, professionals talk about theory, and the public talk about stories and examples and other things. Simpson's kind of going the wrong way by taking theory out of the professional venue and putting it into the popular venue. But I think that's absolutely crucial to see what Simpson is up to. So let's add a fourth model for communication. The fourth model goes something like this. Very simple, very straightforward. That we've got separate spheres, but the spheres are defined by epistemic cultures, by the rules of the game, by expectations. And scientists sometimes choose, because it's a choice, they choose to play by a certain set of rules at certain times, and other sets of rules at other times. So when Simpson is taking a pasting on quantum evolution in the technical literature, he doesn't have enough evidence to make a compelling case that this is a general phenomenon of evolution. So he gets out of that venue. He still thinks he's right. He still thinks he's got a big idea. So what he does is he moves into an equally familiar venue, the popular writing sphere, where the rules are different. And he's making use of the different rules to accomplish a similar task. So different venue, different rules, different epistemic culture, different norms of behavior. What Simpson definitely has for quantum evolution is he's got a good story. He's got a connection to theory. And he has a couple of case studies. The book Horses is a brilliant example of putting those three elements to work to argue the case that his theoretical process really exists in nature and is really worth paying attention to. He can't deliver it in one setting, he shifts setting, and he gets to work on it there. Now, what I think is absolutely fascinating from a popularization point of view is if you ask what the audience is expecting from scientists writing popular science, I think they're not expecting scientists to be skipping over the technical conversation. Or, frankly put, if you lose the technical conversation because you don't have the goods, I don't think people are expecting you to make use of the popular venue in order to win. Now, the other night there was that Attenborough story on my ape hypothesis, which is another example of something that I think systematically has been rejected amongst the professional communities. The aquatic ape hypothesis doesn't work, there's not evidence for it. It doesn't live in that professional community. But Attenborough just didn't show up, and how many people now think that that's a valid view with a couple of dissenting perspectives adding on to it? Don't know, certainly worth thinking about. So, push forward now, very near the end, let me summarize, and leave you with a tantalizing idea for the rest of the day. Simpson, quantum evolution, failure professionally, he tries to get away with it. That's a big idea for thinking about evolutionary theory. I don't think that Simpson is hardened in the way that Gaylord represents. I think his representation of the 20th century evolutionary theory is just false. It's false because he looks in only a few places for evidence and not in lots of places for evidence. That's the evolutionary theory. In the popular science venue, we've got to think about a kind of separate spheres, kind of market, different rules, different cultures, different norms. And scientists choose to communicate in different ways in those different settings. Now, it may be that they only talk certain topics in different settings, different venues, like Ruth says, or sometimes scientists try to exploit the rules of one venue to get other stuff done. That's really important. Now, press forward. Think about some of the topics we've got in our own study today and this afternoon. Paleoart is one of the ones I really want to get, I really want to talk about in my own career. Paleoart is a great example because art, as we all know, art runs by rules not just of technical accuracy, but also rules of art. And so something like composition and color and perspective, those rules, a good set of applications of those ideas in Paleoart can get an argument a long way down the road, even if technical accuracy is either compromised or vague technical accuracy is presented as a detailed accuracy. That is absolutely fascinating, well worth talking about. So, wrap it up. Take a look at Horses, it's a nice book. It's trying to get some work done.